la tercera sesión, donde ya recurrimos a figuras más familiares. Hemos tenido los escritores, hemos tenido los alcaldes, ahora llevamos con el mundo más próximo de la arquitectura. De hecho, Dominique Perrol, que nos acompaña hoy, ha estado ya aquí en Pamplona en un congreso anterior. Iwan Banno, esta es la primera vez que lo tenemos aquí y es estupendo tenerlos juntos. No voy a contarles quiénes son, porque además hemos hecho un folleto donde está su biografía, así que ahorro el esfuerzo de presentarlos. Y simplemente les digo que la sesión va a ser como las anteriores, van a hablar durante un máximo de 40 minutos cada uno y luego van a dialogar entre ellos y con aquellos de ustedes que deseen hacerlo. Así que sin más, Iwan, whenever you want. Thank you.
Thank you for the invitation to speak here tonight. I saw the line of this event was less architecture, more cities. That was exactly what I was trying to show also tonight. A lot of you probably know my work from the architecture publications. I'm hired by many of the well-known architects to document their finished works, but also like follow sometimes construction projects. Like actually, I started with architecture about 13 years ago. I came from a background for more documentary photography. I met kind of by accident Rem Koolhaas just at the time that he started working on the construction of CCTV, this massive building in Beijing. I was really fascinated with that, how such a project comes together.
Sorry, I must ask the people up there. Debo pedir a la gente que apague un poquito las luces, que las haga más bajas para que se puedan ver las imágenes mejor en la pantalla. O sea, así que si son tan amables y me escuchan ahora, en el control de luces, por favor, bájenla todo lo que puedan. Si se pueden luego iluminar cuando tengamos aquí el diálogo, pero ahora incluso el escenario me gustaría que estuviera casi a oscuras. Gracias.
Yes, sorry. Great, perfect. It was an interesting moment at the time that he just started the construction of CCTV, this massive building in Beijing, which really sort of looms over the city. I was totally fascinated by the scale of that project, the time at that moment in China with like everything in the run-up to the Olympics. It was 2005, so still 3 years to come to the Olympics. And these very large-scale government projects, how they influence the city. So it's not only the architecture and the building, but also very much sort of how the city around it was changing, what these construction workers were doing. Like for a project like this, there were at times 10,000 construction workers on site who were all migrant workers who came from the countryside and settled down like in little villages around it. But at the same time, also the evictions of people who lived in the surroundings where houses were torn down and new buildings came up. So for me, that was sort of my crash course into architecture. I followed that project for many years, as well as the Olympic Stadium by Herzog and de Meuron, which you see here in a few pictures during construction. And it's also like a lot of these moments which fascinate me, how we know these large-scale projects from the sort of glorious final images, but especially sort of during construction, how these buildings are made by people who have a sort of whole personal life around these construction sites. Like here at night, they're just having their sort of almost family time next to such a construction site where they're watching TV and having their regular day-to-day activities. I wanted to show a couple of projects more around cities. Of course, a lot of the finished projects, my commissioned work by architects here, for instance, Zaha Hadid, those are large-scale cultural projects, projects which deal also a lot with the city. I like to show that that context and like how it's used, where it is, that it's not just like this sort of perfect fancy line of the architect, but also, yeah, the grittiness of the city around it, like this one. It is in Azerbaijan where she designed this large theater, museum, cultural center in a city, an old former Soviet city. This was a project we just published last year with Harvard on John Portman, the architect who just passed away in end of last year. Until that time, he was still very active. We were working on the book about a year and a half ago when we started on it. I came a number of times to Atlanta, a city which he really defined in a way. Downtown Atlanta was a place where he started in the 70s to build these massive office blocks, hotels, conference centers, and so on. I was lucky to still meet him there in his office, where he still, like he was at the time, 92, came daily into the office, where he's standing here between his models, in the foreground, his buildings in the background, and really immersed by his designs everywhere. And Atlanta is a fascinating place with, like, it's all sort of this infrastructure almost of buildings where, tunnels, underground, tubes overground, which connect all the buildings, a climate which is in the summer extremely hot and humid. He had this whole idea of a whole city which could be lived in inside, basically. A kind of futuristic idea. It's kind of a future, how the future looked 30, 40 years ago. And it's for me always interesting to look at these places again, sort of with a new eye, how they're used these days, how people inhabit these places, how they're changed over time, and how people adapt to that that kind of life. A very vertical city. You sort of walk in between these buildings, sometimes outside, sometimes inside, and it has this whole confined feel throughout the city. And then there's this, all these sort of futuristic pots jettisoning up and down, elevators, the tubes where you go through, this whole interconnectedness, which was a big part of his work at the time. For the book with Harvard, we documented many of his projects there throughout the city, how he really defined that city, how he changed that city, but also visited a number of his other projects around the country. What is also interesting is, like, for instance, a lot of the public artworks there in the city were also designed by him. He was, besides an architect, also an artist. So when you walk through the city, you come across many of his public works, and then you find these kind of moments where almost the people become part of that, the architecture, the art, and everything together. He was very well known for the large atriums, for instance here the Hyatt hotels with these big elevators going up, and then the rotating restaurants on the top. So very futuristic feel what you still have in that in these cities. This is the Marriott Hotel, for instance, also one of these massive atrium buildings. Here we are in San Francisco, the Embarcadero Center, Los Angeles, where it's like this, also this large hotel complex really sort of comes up out of the endless asphalt of the city. And again, this kind of futuristic feel, elevators which come up and down on the outside of the buildings. And then I was also fortunate enough to visit a couple of his houses. He built two houses for himself. This was the first one, which he built in the end of the 60s, and really a sort of first way to implement his ideas. All the columns, he had this idea of these exploded columns where actually a lot of things happen inside. So the elevators, for instance, ran through these columns in his larger buildings. But then in his home, where everything is, of course, in a much smaller scale, you see there's still, the circulation happens inside, like the staircases, which run inside these columns up, or the library, which is inside one of the other columns. And it's this whole idea which he brought there for the first time. And his other house, his weekend house on the Gulf, outside Atlanta, there on the sea, this massive white concrete building on the sea there, which was really interesting to visit there. And also there it's a whole exhibition center at the same time, where he shows not only his architectural ideas but also his art, which is everywhere intertwined with the architecture. You step in another, this kind of future from a while ago, the 80s home where everything was connected and high tech, and still the same housekeeper who is there every day and knows exactly how to program each light with a kind of 80s way of doing it. You have to plug in a box and type in a code, but he was the one who still ran the whole house well. And then the sort of small exhibition spaces throughout the houses. Here we are in Doha, Qatar. OMA just finished there, these two buildings, the headquarters of the Qatar Foundation, this massive cube which is sitting there in the desert, and the library, this diamond shape, very flat, big open library space, which was really interesting to see there in the education city, this whole new part of Qatar, Doha, Qatar, which is being built there. And this aerial perspective is always important in my work. I like not to only focus on these details of the building and how they're built, but also really step back from the architecture, show the context where they're actually built. And for me, it's also a sort of way to stay kind of awake. I'm always traveling, and like you sometimes wake up, where the heck am I this day? And actually stepping back away from the architecture and really showing that context, where it is, the relationship with the rest of the city around it, how the city around it grows around these kind of architectural icons, is really interesting for me. Like here, Dubai, the Burj Khalifa, the tallest tower still in the world. And you sometimes see also the strangeness of these places, like this wide open desert place where there's this one row where all the towers come up. And then, of course, one of them has to be the tallest in the world, but actually there's so much space around it. Why all these towers, you have to question sometimes. Or here we're in Paris with the Fondation Louis Vuitton, from Frank Gehry. Sao Paulo, one of these endless cities which goes on forever. And then you see these buildings which we know as the architectural icons, the Oscar Niemeyer building, but it's in this, when you step away, it almost disappears in this sea of high rises around it. And then very old cities like Kyoto here, with the large imperial gardens, these massive super blocks in the city. And when you step away, you fly high above the city, you see this incredible grid of this old city and how it grew and grew and got more densely pixelated in a way, except for these big institutions like these imperial gardens, the large government complexes there. Mexico City, one of the informal neighborhoods, but still like also a place where there's a lot of organization. People build their own houses in a way, but there's a very strict grid to it. Or Los Angeles here with its highways. And at night, where this grid, like a city of highways, really becomes visible. Miami here, and what's really striking when you fly high above the city, how incredibly flat it is and just literally floats on top of the water. And you see also like what kind of challenges the city will get in the coming years with its rising sea levels there. Chicago, with its high rises and the center of the city, but also the incredible flatlands around it. And like Chicago, we know so much of all the high rises, but actually the average building height there in the city is just 2 stories, which you really see when you take the distance from the city and see the incredible flatness of the rest of the city around it. Or here in Tokyo, which is still so much defined by its old waterways throughout the city, which over time became highways, became all the interconnections in the city, and how a city grew around that. New York, with the Four Freedoms Park. And there was this picture which I took 5 years ago, just the day after the big superstorm Sandy hit, where half the city was without electricity. And that's also one of these moments when you really step away and you keep that distance, where you can understand what kind of impact building cities and these extraordinary moments have on a city. This is Nairobi, Kibera, one of the largest slums in northern Africa, about 1 million people who live there, and here flying over it, you see this incredible pattern of that neighborhood, where with very narrow streets and a sort of continuous roof of corrugated steel. I was there, I proposed a small project to do there with Selgas Cano, the Spanish architects. They did the year before this beautiful small vaccination center, really in the countryside of Kenya, really far away, like you had to go with a 4x4, 5 hours drive outside the nearest little airstrip there. So it's all built with very basic materials, corrugated steel, some scaffolding pipes. That was the only things they brought in, and for the rest, just materials from the site. When I was there in Kibera, this slum, I was working with a small school which had a big fire a couple of years before and was struggling to find a place again for the school. And at the same time, Selgas Cano was asked by the Louisiana Museum, which you see here, the gardens of the Louisiana Museum, to make a small pavilion for a large Africa show the museum was doing. So we proposed to actually build the new school, which was very much needed there in Kibera, in Kenya. Built it first there for the exhibition at the Louisiana Museum, and after the exhibition ended 3 months later, they dismantled the whole structure, put it in a container, and brought it back to Kibera. Here you see the city again from above, and how the school is built exactly in the spot where the original school was standing. So they took the measurements of the original school, 8 tiny classrooms in this incredible informal city, and built it with, again, very basic materials, scaffolding pipes, corrugated steel, corrugated plastics, and it was all paid for by the exhibition in Denmark at the Louisiana Museum. And after the exhibition, it had a real life there as a school in Kibera, where it serves now. I go quickly through these. And what was also a big part of it, like Kibera, for until recently, it didn't have any toilets, public toilets or private toilets. And it was also a place known for the invention of the flying toilet, which was basically people were doing their thing in a little bag and then throw it as far away as possible. So all the roofs were basically littered with feces and so. So a big thing for the city over the last year years was to start building public toilets in this incredible neighborhood. And a big part of the school was also yet to teach children how to use actually a toilet and how to use water and hygiene. So what Selgas and Lucia did there was also bringing the water through the scaffolding pipes and bringing the toilet really as a sort of centerpiece there in the building. And a very open building, like where sort of the neighborhood can peek in, can see what happens there. There's a small playground, like in a neighborhood where there's absolutely zero public space. Every inch basically is used. So a big part of what of the site, of the still very tiny site, was yeah, to keep an open place there where kids could play and have performances and do their things. Let me go quickly through these. Here you see still a few more aerial views of how it really fits in this incredible neighborhood there. And since the roof was made of this translucent corrugated plastic, like at night it became really this sort of icon and beacon there in that neighborhood. This is another project I worked on over the last couple of years with Manuel Hertz and the ETH in Zurich. He had a big interest in how modernism evolved there in on the African continent over the last decades. And especially on these countries which all were in a moment of like independence in the 50s, 60s, 70s, and as part of their independence, hired mainly foreign architects, often from their former colonizers, to build their large government buildings, universities, public housing, and all these kind of things, and really sort of make a statement like, this is our new capital, this is our new city, and so. And it was, of course, the time that like cities like Brasilia and Chandigarh were also built. So very much with that in mind, there were a number of examples over the African continent where similar things were happening, which have been rarely documented before. I was really fascinated also by that subject, and again, sort of how these structures are now used almost half a century later. And especially on a continent there, like Africa, of course, there's very little documentation about these projects. Architecture is really a sort of byproduct. The needs for anything else are often much higher. And it really becomes sort of this background in the city, which is really interesting to see. Here we're in Ivory Coast. This is Yamoussoukro. The was a completely new built capital in the center of the country. Big, wide, open streets. Big ideas at that time to build the new capital, like Brasilia, in the middle of the country. The presidential palace, which sits in the middle of the city with a big canal around it, with its natural defense, as you can see in the corner, to protect the president, but also beautiful small university buildings, schools, and all these government buildings throughout the city. Often not in their best state anymore, but very well used and really, important pieces of architecture in a context like that. And what was interesting, also the Catholic Church built an exact copy of the Vatican there. And here you see it in front of the large slum which sits there in front, and then this massive building of the Vatican in the back. And they thought the Vatican was not big enough, so they enlarged the whole building 1.5 times. So it's actually really out of scale, which you can see here. And when you go inside, inside these columns are actually the elevators going up to the second floor and so on. So a strange place. Strange building to find there in the on the African continent. Here we're in Dakar, Senegal, also one of these places where a lot of this modernist architecture was happening, from public buildings, housing like these, to large exhibition centers. And what was really interesting, like at the time, was a place where architects could experiment also a lot with this tropical modernism. There was, of course, little technology, no air conditioning or things available at the time there. So it's a lot with working with these louvers, creating shade, creating natural ventilation. And of course, sort of the natural ventilation is starting to being used as storage spaces for anything else as well. But that's also the beauty of these things, that things can evolve over time and people really start using these places. This is a large exhibition center in the outskirts of the city. Incredible place with these big triangular buildings littered through the site, and this triangle shape sort of followed through to the smallest details. And again, like a big public building, but at the same time, anything happens there. People live in it, people do their laundry in there, and it's really becoming part of the life there in Senegal. Here we're in Lusaka, the capital of Zambia. They called it also the Los Angeles of Africa. For me, the sort of only resemblance with LA was the sort of endless flatness and its small city center with a few high-rises where the government and the National Bank and buildings like that were sitting, which were all also this part of this post-colonial, post-independence built-up. Interesting public markets where everything is sold and resold and reused, and like this incredible DVD shop where I stumbled upon, where every DVD is shown almost as a building material, filling the walls, the columns, the ceilings, and everything else. Universities, again, which are a big part of that whole rebuilding process, also with very simple materials, just a screen of louvers, which lets air through, light through, but not the bright sunlight. Interesting student dormitories, very much Louis Kahn inspired, tiny dormitories where two or three students live together in a small bedroom, and then a sort of open corridor where the more public life happened, and the kitchen and gathering spaces were in the middle. The parliament building of Lusaka with these large stuffed animals in the middle. And here we're in Kenya again. Nairobi, the city center with its incredible bus station, this sort of whirlpool of minibuses which turns around, a very lively place, with the Kenyatta Center, which you see here in the center, which was, when it was built end 60s, early 70s, was the tallest building on the African continent, partly businesses which are in there, and partly the government, which holds seats in that triangular-shaped big auditorium with beautiful sort of natural light coming through. And also this use of the dark, heavy concrete in contrast with the bright, hot outside, just creating large shaded spaces where people can sit, rest, and enjoy their place. The University of Nairobi, also with this beautiful invention of the screened facades, and one of the large markets, a very simple sort of umbrella structure which you see scattered around the market, where people take shelter in, which gives them shelter to the rain. A very simple structure to build, but also very graphic and a big statement for a place like that, where people really sort of surrounded by all their wares which they sell, and like these two women who are sitting there really buried in anything what they sell there on the market. This is another project I did with Manuel Hertz 2 years ago for the Venice Architecture Biennial in Algeria. We proposed to do the first Western Sahara country pavilion. The Western Sahara was this country below Morocco which just basically the day after their independence was annexed by Morocco and still sits in this limbo where many people fled the country in the 70s, were taken in by Algeria, and there's still these large refugee camps in the middle of the Sahara where nowadays 160,000 refugees live. And you see also this fact of, that there was a big, at that time, 1975, I believe, these people fled their country, were taken in by Algeria. UNHCR provided tents and all the temporary refugee housing, but we're now 40 years later, and these people are still there and built a kind of incredible city out of nothing in the middle of nowhere there. It's a kind of almost a science fiction place, you see, there in the middle of the Sahara where there's absolutely nothing. They built a whole city from scrap materials, and at the same time everything works there. They built schools, they have a sort of functioning government in exile there, and there's four main cities which we photographed, and we photographed this sort of daily life and the aspirations of people there. So you see the shops, all the sort of things you see in a regular city which people built there with their own hands there, and even like the Zara found its way there, and countless little shops where you step into, which are incredibly designed with whatever kind of materials people could find there. Even the Carrefour made it out there. I'm not sure if they know exactly that it was there, but at least people find under the most incredible circumstances ways to live, and these sort of temporary solutions over time become permanent, and people now whole generation of course grew up there with no end in sight to ever come back. Even like the photo studios where you take your family portraits at the important moments throughout your life. The sort of local IKEA where you buy all the inventory for your houses. The hairdressers, the graveyard even. A graveyard, you couldn't make the gravestone, so whatever kind of stone or material you could find to mark a grave is used there, but even with such a simple gesture, you know sort of where you are. And then, houses and buildings and people, everything is almost made from recycled and reused materials. In incredibly fragile ways, of course. Like even sort of the walls are reused cars, anything what could be found, but then also like all kind of architectural aspirations, what people see in pictures, what people remember, they are using, like they're building columns, they're decorating their houses. Some houses are incredibly refined with nice porches and all kind of details. And this was one of the interesting ones also, like this nice entrance door with the porch. But then when you look closely and see how the arch is made, it's actually, they used an old car tire to as a kind of formwork to build their front door. But what is interesting is that it's not only the people, but there's still like a functioning government there also, which works in exile. This is their defense department, this building. It's not very well camouflaged in a way, but like very prominent building there in the city center. Their Department of Housing, and here's the Parliament of the Sahrawi people. Which comes there together once in a while in this building. So all these things are still present even in these very informal conditions. So we presented this pavilion, we made a large tent there, which sat there in the center of the Giardini, where we presented these stories of the people, the photographs, a number of photographs on the walls, and video loops. And we asked the women of the Sahrawi foundations to make three large carpets showing a number of their prime important buildings, which they made into these carpets, and showing the history of how these people, where they traveled, and how they came together, and a map of the place there. This was the women, the leader of the Sahrawi women group who made the carpets. I quickly want to show you this project. Here we are in Caracas, Venezuela. Also again a place which had an incredible potential. This was supposed to be the tallest building in Caracas when it was built in the 70s, early 80s, just before the collapse of the economy there. It was supposed to be the largest, the headquarters of the largest bank of Venezuela. The economy crashed, the bank went bankrupt, the developer died, and the building stood empty for many years. It's just a concrete carcass of the building, a construction site, where over the last decade about 3,000 people moved into that construction site and built a whole vertical city themselves inside that construction site. So it was a place, there were no elevators, no handrails, nothing a real building has. But in a place like Caracas, where 70% of the population lives in these slums, in the informal favelas, they needed to find places wherever they could build a place for themselves. And these favelas are violent places. This building they could control in a way, like it was, there's one entrance to the building where everyone, all these 3,000 people who live in there, come in and out from. They know exactly who's there. And this was a much safer alternative for many of these people. And also there you see all these decisions of how people create a place for themselves. Here, this is the lobby, the main entrance. People paint it nicely. They plant a tree in this concrete place, and they make it into a public place where kids play basketball and everything. But at the same time, you see everywhere the remnants of a real construction site. There's staircases up to the 40th floor without handrails, huge open gaps in the building, etc., etc. Connected to the building, you see there's a parking garage, 15 stories tall. And since there was no elevators in the building, they decided to set up a taxi service, basically, in the parking garage, with taxis driving the whole day just up and down, basically to bring people and goods up and down in the building. And so the parking garage is at certain levels connected to the rest of the building. Every floor has its own little shops, people who just made a hole in the wall, they live there, but at the same time sell all the basic needs to survive there in a place. And then once you step into these apartments, it's incredible to see how people built their personal spaces, like from incredibly detailed to very basic moments, like here people who just move in, who absolutely have nothing, but once they move in, they have already a roof over their head, so they just define a space with some curtains, some sheets hanging around them, and slowly over time, whenever they have some money, they start buying some building materials, and slowly you see these walls rise and rise and becoming more and more of a defined space. And people often, when you live on the 28th floor, you have no elevator, it's not easy to get down, so their whole life starts to happen on that floor. There's like little shops, like little factories, everything is happening in there, the hairdressers, the shops, and even like here on the 28th floor where there's the gym, the guy who found an unused parts of the elevators which were never installed and uses them as the weight in the building. This is an example of a place in the Philippines, Manila, the north of the Philippines, north of Manila, where there's this large cemetery with all these small mausoleums, and also there again a place with an incredible shortage for people to live. People started to invade all these small mausoleums, and now that cemetery is not only a cemetery, but it's also a city where 10,000 people live in between these graves, and everything happens there, on top and inside and around these graves. So it's little shops in there, people sleep in there, people make their homes, people go to school there, and it's for them the most normal thing basically to live there. For us, a kind of extraordinary place. And then once a year, during the Day of the Dead, all these people move out, and it's still a place to think about the people before. And it's incredible how that sort of context can disappear for people who are there every day, and where that became a sort of normal livelihood for. I would like to end with this project. Here we are in Africa again, Ethiopia, Lalibela. It's a place which was created about 1,000 years ago. It's a whole landscape which is incredibly carved out. There's about 11 churches which were carved out there in the rocks, but not like in Petra or places like that where it's into a wall, into the side of a mountain. But here there's an incredible three-dimensional space carved out in the rock down below. I was there a few years ago during Ethiopian Christmas. They have the Coptic calendar, so their Christmas is always a little bit a different moment, end of the year, end of December, early January. So I was there during Ethiopian Christmas, where thousands and thousands of pilgrims still come to that site, and even a place like that, which is 1,000 years old, becomes completely alive again. It's a kind of architecture where it's not by building something up, to make a space, but it's all removing materials and creating a kind of negative space to create a final place to be used. So this whole landscape is kind of carved out with trenches going down into the earth, small tunnels underground, and then people crawling in and crawling out from these places, because the entrance to these actual churches is then down below in that pit where the church is. Of course, over the years you see like how people altered it, and how it's sort of carved out and worn out, but the incredible beauty of sometimes very detailed moments, architectural moments, how things are designed and really thought out, like you cannot make a mistake. It's all carved material, or all a sort of final part, and then sort of the roughness of the rock and the place around it. And of course the light inside is very special, some moments during the day where the sun really shines all the way down there, but most of the time of the day it's just a kind of the reflected red light from the red rocks which comes inside these spaces. And then all kind of details which you see even carved out into these windows, into these places again. And then also all kind of architectural details, really, like the columns, these rows of columns, like, it's probably not structurally necessary, but they knew it, they implemented that, and they went to incredible great lengths to carve out these spaces. And then once you really get inside these churches, there's another whole level of a kind of negative space, which is all made from removed materials to create an actual space and an experience there. And then this is one of the most impressive ones, where you are underground, coming out of one of these spaces, and then there's another very deep space going down all the way into sort of nothingness, which people create just to create that kind of experience. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Iwan Ban, for this it's a tour alrededor del mundo, this tour around the world through 800 images that ended up very appropriately for Dominique, because it ended with subterranean architecture, which is your theme today. Thank you. So, Dominique.